This is a democracy. It is not an elected autocracy. We need to remind this government. The PM CARES Fund diverts those very funds away from local communities into this dark hole where not even a speck of light can enter. To this government, I say, stop lying to us all the time about growth rates, about migrant welfare, about expenditure, and the laughable delusion that the PM cares. The government issued a circular on March 28, 2020, notifying that all contributions to the PM CARES Fund qualified as eligible CSR contributions under Item 8, Schedule 7 of the Companies Act. But it also disqualified contributions made to the state relief funds from being treated as valid CSR activities. But this was earlier expressly permissible under Schedule 7 of the Act of 2013. So unfair treatment of identical contributions to the PM CARES and to the state relief funds is against public interest, is against public policy. It completely disincentivizes corporate contributions which the state governments would otherwise have got. It creates an unfair, unjust and discriminatory distinction against the state and chief minister's relief funds in favor of the PM CARES funds. The Honourable Minister, while introducing the bill yesterday, read out a long list of school children and pensioners who had apparently readily and happily given away their meagre savings to the PM CARES Fund. But the Honourable Minister was strangely silent on the 38 PSUs that donated more than 2,100 crores to the fund. Almost 70% of the fund's corpus comes from 38 PSU donations. These are public sector undertakings, share capital subscribed to by the Government of India out of public money. Without an audit, the conflict of interest is writ large for anyone to see. I hope you remember that the Prime Minister's office, in response to an application seeking disclosure of the incorporating documents of this trust, had said this is not a public authority, hence it's not open to RTI. But the very legislative intent behind Section 135 of the Companies Act was to encourage companies to use CSR funds for local welfare activities for local communities in areas of operation. But the PM CARES Fund diverts those very funds away from local communities into this dark hole where not even a speck of light can enter. Coal India has committed 221 crores to a fund while it cannot contribute to the state relief funds of Bengal and Jharkhand where it has 90% of its operations. ONGC has mentioned that it has offered funds from its CSR budget for the year even though the allocation is not yet determined. Power Finance Corporation contributed 200 crores to the PM CARES Fund even though its entire CSR allocation is only 150 crores. It's almost like the courtiers of the emperor are competing with each other to give gifts to the emperor with public funds. If these improprieties were not enough, then please consider the massive donations made by Chinese companies. This is horrific. Xiaomi, a Chinese company accused of snooping on people, gave the fund 10 crores. TikTok, currently banned by this government only a few weeks ago, gave 30 crores. Huawei, banned around the world for its well-documented links to the Chinese army, gave 10 crores. Why did you take this money from our enemies? Why don't you return this tainted money? I'm sure no dying Indian would want to be on a ventilator paid for by enemy money at this time. Would they? I ask you, you say you have put 2,000 crores towards the purchase of 50,000 ventilators. Please lay on the table of this house how many ventilators have been physically delivered to which hospitals, to which states. Also tell us the manner of procurement. The way airwaves and the way airports are sold in this country to crony capitalists, I hope this procurement was not done by those same individuals. This is a question that we need to ask. And the dangers of these unverified foreign donations are amplified by the fact that the PM CARES Fund is exempt from FCRA regulations, even though it doesn't meet the precondition of a body whose funds are audited by the CAG. You are bringing the PM CARES Fund under the ambit of the same clause that governs the Prime Minister's National Relief Fund, the existing fund. What is the need to institute a new fund where one exists? Prime Ministers will come and go, but the existence of a fund is not up for discussion. What is this need to name everything after one individual? What is this need? This is a democracy. It is not an elected autocracy. We need to remind this government. First, you are raising funds on the basis of public office. The very name, a Prime Minister's fund, makes people think this is government authority. So by saying it is not open to RTI, you are running away from the spirit of transparency you claim to be wedded to. Second, cabinet ministers are trustees administering the funds. So you are impermissibly expanding the scope of your ministerial office in excess of the mandate determined by the Constitution. The third, you are commandeering resources. Donations are done by default. A circular issued on April 17 by the Department of Revenue under the Ministry of Finance told every officer and staff of the Government of India to contribute one day's salary till March 21. This would be deducted. If they wish to not donate, they should put this in writing. Tell me, in this atmosphere of fear and vengeance currently prevalent in this country, which bureaucrat, which public officer will say they do not wish to donate? I have only a few minutes left, and so bear with my bluntness. To this government, I say, stop lying to us all the time about growth rates, about migrant welfare, about expenditure, and the laughable delusion that the PM cares. Stop marketing 20,000 crore packages as relief measures when in truth it comprises money already spent and money to be given as loans, an imaginary money that will never reach the people it is supposed to. Stop cheating the state governments of their dues made through a constitutional promise. Stop wasting funds on vanity projects when the state governments who actually make a difference are deprived time and again. And so, I end by saying that today's India reminds me of Hans Christian Andersen's story, The Emperor's New Clothes, where the emperor was cloaked in nothing, but his sycophantic courtiers could not tell him so. The Bengali poet Nirendranath Chakravorty, in his poem Ulongo Raja, said only one small innocent little boy in the entire kingdom had the courage to stand up and ask the naked emperor, Raja, tor kapur koi? Today I ask the same question, Emperor, where are your clothes?